The Bible reads from verse 1.
And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Send men,
to spy out the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the children of Israel. From each tribe of their fathers you shall send a man,
everyone a leader among them. So Moses sent them from the wilderness of Paran according to the command of the Lord.
All of them, men who were heads of the children of Israel. Now these were the names of the tribes of the tribe of Reuben, and then it begins to give us the names. And then the Bible says in verse 16, these are the names of the men whom Moses sent to spy out the land. And Moses called Hoshea, the son of Nun, Joshua. Then Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said to them, spy out the land of Canaan and said to them, go up this way into the south and go up to the mountains and see what the land is like, whether the people who dwell in it are strong or weak, few or many, whether the land they dwell in is good or bad, whether the cities they inhabit are like camps or strongholds, whether the land is rich or poor, and whether there are forests there or not. Be of good courage and bring some of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the season of the first ripe grapes. So they went up and spied out the land from the wilderness of Zin as far as Rehob, near the entrance of Hamath. And they went up through the south and came to Hebron.
Ahiman, Sheshai, Talmai, the descendants of Anak, were there. Now Hebron was built 7 years before Zon in Egypt. Now the Bible, it reads in verse 26. Now they departed and came back to Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness of Paran and Kadesh. They brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. Then they told him and said, we went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong. The cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and along the banks of the Jordan. All right?
Let me read again.
Then they told him and said, we went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Nevertheless, the people who dwelt in the land are strong. Rather, who dwell in the land are strong. The cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south. The Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and along the banks of the Jordan. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, we bless you. Lord, we glorify and we magnify you. In Jesus' mighty name I pray, amen and amen. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it. All right, let me just read
the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 1. I'm not going to be long. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 19. So we departed from Horeb and went through all that great and terrible wilderness, which you saw on the way to the mountains of the Amorites, as the Lord our God had commanded us. Then we came to Kadesh Barnea, and I said to you, you have come to the mountains of the Amorites, which the Lord your God is giving us. Look, the Lord your God has set the land before you. Go up and possess it, as the Lord God of your fathers have spoken to you. Do not fear or be discouraged. And everyone you came near to me and said, let us send men before us, and let them search out the land for us, and bring back word to us of the way by which we should go up, and of the cities into which we shall come. The plan pleased me well, so I took 12 of your men, one man from each tribe, and they departed and went up into the mountains, and came to the valley of Eshcol, and spied it out. Then rather they also took some of the fruit of the land in their hands and brought it down to us. And they brought back word to us, saying, it is a good land which the Lord our God is giving us. Nevertheless, you would not go up, but rebelled against the command of your God. And you complained in your tents and said, because the Lord hates us, he has brought us out of the land of Egypt to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites, to destroy us. Where can we go up? Our brethren have discouraged our hearts, saying, the people are greater and taller than we. The cities are great and fortified up to heaven. Moreover, we have seen the sons of the Anakim there, which is the giants. Then I said to you, do not be terrified or afraid of them. The Lord your God, who goes before you, he will fight for you according to all he did for you in Egypt before your eyes. And in the wilderness where you saw how the Lord your God carried you, in other words, God's deliverance and God's provision, as a man carries his son in all the way that you went until you came to this place. Yet for all that you did not believe the Lord your God, who went in the way before you to search out a place for you, to pitch your tent, to show you the way you should go in the fire, in the fire by night and in the cloud by day. In other words, he was guiding them as a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day. And the Lord heard the sound of your words and was angry and took an oath. Then it continues and continues. What a wonderful time. I just enjoyed reading the story. I hope you did too. Oh, not unless I was reading to myself. The book of Numbers chapter 13, it gives us a narrative that the Lord commanded. Is it not amazing that when we read from the book of Deuteronomy chapter 1, Deuteronomy, it is the repetition of God's law, because they were now at the brink of transition. Transition 1, Moses is about to go and be with the Lord, and he knows that. And 2, he also knows that I have to transfer the baton to the next generation, to another man who's going to take over God's inheritance into the promised land. Now the Bible, it tells us that Moses, he reminds that, now when you read it from the book of Deuteronomy, it is a narrative Moses that is giving, and giving them the perspective of what happened in Kadesh Barnea. It's like narrating a story that happened in the past, but repeating it deliberately, so that as you sabotaged your breakthrough 40 years ago, I am repeating that story. I am narrating, I am conveying, I am giving you
you a forensic report. What led to the children of Israel wandering and scattering and dying in the wilderness without crossing over the river Jordan to take over their inheritance? Now I know that you are wilderness survivors, because the majority of you, you were born in the wilderness. Now it is important to give you now a lecture based on what happened to my generation, your fathers, your grandparents, because the generation that was about to cross over the river Jordan with Joshua and Caleb, they were born in the wilderness. Now, if you have to speak about the trauma, if you have to speak about the suppression and the oppression of Egypt, they did not experience that firsthand. All right, but now they find themselves being born in the wilderness because of the unbelief of their forefathers. Now you appreciate that the Bible, as it is written, things are compressed and summarized. So which means this generation, even though they were born in the wilderness, they understood how slavery shaped the personality, how it shaped the identities, how it shaped the character, how it shaped the mindset of their parents. Because according to Numbers chapter 13, Moses, he sends 12 spies to go and spy the land of Canaan. Now the Bible says they came back with a good report. Only two of them did, but the 10 came back with a negative report. Now if you were listening attentively when I read chapter 1 in the book of Deuteronomy, Moses is repeating a phrase in that chapter, not once, not twice. He tells them about the negative implications of this. He says, your forefathers were discouraged. Why they were discouraged? It is because there was a pessimistic report that they subscribed to. Why they were discouraged? It is because there was a report of limitation and impossibility that they subscribed to. Why they were discouraged? It is because there was a malicious report that was to a point where it disarmed. Discouragement speaks about disarming your courage. Discouragement, hallelujah. In other words, their courage, it was polluted, it was contaminated by the report that they received. It means that the report that they received, it carried with it a voice of sabotage, a voice of abortion, a voice of frustration, a voice of doubt, a voice of fear, that it had a clear intention of disarming and replacing their faith. Now they are discouraged. They were discouraged. Now, you know, as I explore it from Numbers, again, you must understand that and when we explore it from Deuteronomy, Moses is looking at it hindsight. Right? Hindsight. I'll come to that point, why it is important. Now the Bible, it says that they came with this a negative report, and it caused them to sin because they started to doubt what God said. Is it possible? Is it true? Are we going to take over the land that God has given us? We can see the grapes, we can see the pomegranates, we can see the goodness that God spoke about. But now they told us that the men, according to the book of Deuteronomy, these men are taller, they are cities, they are delivering. Where can we go up? Our brethren have discouraged our hearts, saying, the people are greater.
and taller than me. The cities are great and fortified up to heaven. Have you ever seen that? Have you ever seen that? Did the scripture say that? Even the Tower of Babel that they attempted to build, that it has to reach heaven. The Bible doesn't record that it reached the heavens. Are we together here? The people are great. In other words, we saw the giants of Anak. These men are huge. They are gigantic. Their voice is intimidating. And therefore, there's absolutely no way that we will take over the land. They are stronger than us. Hallelujah. And that's why then the Bible tells us we saw ourselves as grasshoppers. So we were in their sight. But now the Bible says in the book of Numbers, but Caleb created the people. Next to him it was Joshua, who agreed with the report of Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite from the tribe of Judah, who quieted the people and said, children of Israel, I'm paraphrasing it, let us go up and possess the land. Let us go up and do what and take over what belongs to us. Our God is able, hallelujah, in the midst of voices of negativity, voices of discouragement, voices of fear of the unknown, voices of doubt, voices of failure, voices of death, but there was a voice of reason, hallelujah, that rose up and said, no, we are able. Why we are able? It is because our God is able, hallelujah. We have, we have the sufficient power, hallelujah, to prevail. We have the resources to prevail, hallelujah. We have the divine enablement to grab the pool by its horns, hallelujah. We do have the ability, and the ability, it does not come from our own wisdom, it does not come from our own strength, it does not come from our own knowledge and experience, but that ability, it is an ability that is given by God, hallelujah. Because our God is able, let us go and once and possess the land. Now in the book of Deuteronomy, now Moses is reminding them, because what happened there, they ended up complaining against God. They ended up fighting. I mean, Moses telling him that you brought us out of slavery only to scatter our corpses away in the wilderness as if there were no graves in Egypt. Then they went on to say, you brought us out to make us and our children, I mean, victims of the wilderness. And God said exactly what you have said. You have planned your destiny. But Lord, the power of life and death is in the tongue. The tongue is a pen, hallelujah. You can author, you can reauthor, let me put it so, your destiny, your future, by the power of your pen, which is the tongue, hallelujah. Because the power of life and death is in the tongue. It is the Bible that tells me that my tongue shall be satisfied by the fruits of my lips, hallelujah. So which means whenever I decree, I declare, I am ordering that which I want to feast on the table, hallelujah. If therefore, if it's going to feed my tummy, is it going to nourish me? Is it going to contribute positively in my life? If it's going to nourish me, if it is going to edify me, if it is going to propel me, so what is my God desired destiny? So which means the words I speak, they must be words of life. They must be words of victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because the power of life and death is in the tongue. And God said exactly what you have said, because they were playing, the victim mentality, that no, you brought us out only to kill us. And then God God said, you are going to die here, but your children will enter. Your children, they will enter, hallelujah, as you have said it with your mouth. You know, and you know, I remember a young man who heard and saw that Saul was dead. And he knew that Saul is dead. And Saul, he was a self-pronounced, you must mark that, self-pronounced enemy of David. David never viewed Saul as an enemy. Saul was an unprovoked enemy of David because of his brokenness within that caused insecurities. And he became jealous and envious of David and began to hate and honor and harass David, wanted to kill him. But when this young man saw that he's dead, he ran to David with excitement to tell David that your enemy is dead. And by the way, acting as if he is the one who killed the enemy of David. But Saul was already dead. Do you hear what I'm saying? Saul was already dead. And then when he comes as if, yeah, I'm the one who gave him the last blow. I took him out. But instead of David celebrating, instead of David giving him a paycheck and a promotion, and he knelt down and in trembling, I'm paraphrasing it, when you're not afraid to touch the Lord's anointed, hallelujah, because he thought that David is going to be excited. You have avenged, hallelujah, me from my enemy. But instead, David said, as you have said, to get the story. You get the story. Oh, you killed him. Oh, you took him out. Oh, you finished him. As you have said, it is your own, your blood shall not be upon me. Your own mouth has testified against you. Therefore, he commanded the young man to stack him to death. He died for something he did not do. But his tongue panned, hallelujah, his execution. Because he thought that he's going to buy his way up to David by giving him a toxic report. Hallelujah. And these people, they said words. Now, let me give you the context here. God said to them, go in and possess. That's what God said. Go in and take over. Your breakthrough has come. Seize it. Hallelujah. Go, possess it. But they said no, they refused to take the promised land. And the Bible tells me after the Lord pronounced a judgment upon them, he said the 40 days that the spies spent spying the land of Canaan, I am turning that 40 day exploration of Canaan into 40 years. That's how 40 years came about. I'm turning into 40 years. And there shall be a year. Hallelujah. And then, as God said there, later, mark this, later, they felt like, you know, God's timing will never wait for your timing. When God's timing is ripe, he will tell you what around the walls of Jericho once a day, on the seventh day, walk seven times. Your logic. It does not make sense to your listening. Why should I walk around the walls? Hallelujah. Instead of combating, instead of fighting the enemy. But it is going where it's God's timing. It has absolutely nothing to do with appealing to your logic. It has absolutely nothing to do with waiting for your resources. Let me repeat it. What do I mean by saying your resources? When God says possess it, when you look at yourself, you are incapacitated. When God says possess it, when you look at yourself, you feel like I don't have the connections for me to take it over. Hallelujah. When God says possess it, you feel like, no, man, I don't have the qualification to have this head. Possess it. And whenever he says possess, you look at yourself, I am Christ who strengthens me. Why God is saying, possess it, because he knows that I am more than a conqueror through Christ who loves me. Hallelujah. Why God is saying, possess it, he knows that I choose the weak things of this world to shame the strong, the foolish of this world to shame the wise, so that no flesh should glory in my presence. For my power is magnified in your weaknesses, at the point of your weakness, at the point of your vulnerability, at the point of your uncertainty. But today and tomorrow, your God, who's great and mighty in battle, he shows up. That's why David, when his scripture says, arise, Jehovah, and let your enemies be scattered. Vision has nothing to do with your pocket. Vision has nothing to do with your bank account. Vision has nothing to do with your place of birth. That's why they said, can any good thing come out of way of Nazareth? There's absolutely no way that a ruler can emerge from Nazareth. Hallelujah. There's absolutely no way. Even you, Bethlehem, hallelujah. Small as you are, despised as you are, overlooked as you are, a ruler that comes forth, hallelujah, out of Bethlehem, born in a manger, in a stable. Why? Because a vision has nothing to do with your heart, with your place of birth. Does it matter? Does it matter who could have known that a young man coming from Ephesus, a young man coming from the rural areas, and not only him, the many of them, hallelujah, but who became a global icon. Why? Because of fighting for the rights of the oppressed, hallelujah, entering prison for 27 years, but coming out preaching reconciliation, forgiveness, being an advocate of peace, not of hatred. Hallelujah. Why? Because your place of birth does not determine how you become successful in life. Hallelujah. You may be born in a place unknown. Unknown, even the GPS doesn't even know it. You are trying to navigate your way to this Google map, these maps, they must be updated. It might be overlooked by Google company. It might be overlooked by Apple Maps. But I am here to tell you, God knows it, and God knows you by your name. Hallelujah. When he spoke to Elijah, and that Elijah, it's not the time to die. It's not the time to quit. It's not the time to bury. Your prophetic anointing and ministry is the rise up from fear and intimidation. Rise up from discouragement and go and anoint Elisha and Hazel and Jehu. He knew the location of Elisha, who was unknown to Elijah. He knows you by your name. He knows you by your name. He will locate you. Why? Because you are marked for greatness. He will locate you. Why? Because you are appointed for destiny. He will locate you. Hold on, oh, Shanda. Zikamata, he will shine. When the time had come for Samuel to inaugurate and to announce Saul, the son of Kish, as a king over Israel, as the king rather of the Israelites. In 1 Samuel chapter 10, the Bible tells me when the hour had come, the kingly anointing awaited for Saul. Now publicly, because the public one becomes the confirmation of the anointing you received privately. Hallelujah. There's an order that was bought by Samuel privately. And now, for the sake of the people, it becomes the confirmation. Hallelujah. Before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. and set you apart for such a time as this to be a prophet Jeremiah and to the nations. And Mordecai is saying to Esther, who knows whether you were born for such a time as this, hallelujah. And now the time had come, they are kingly anointing. It was waiting to be poured as a confirmation upon Saul that I have marked you for greatness, that I have marked you, hallelujah, as the first king of Israel. I have marked you part of the assignment that God had for Saul. Hallelujah. It was to annihilate the Amalekites. Hallelujah. It was to break the spell of the Amalekites. Break the spell of witchcraft of the Amalekites. Break the spell of divination of the Amalekites. Who were the unprovoked enemies of Israel? Hallelujah. They were provoked by the rising of Israel, by the progression of Israel, by the development and the deliverance of Israel from the oppression of the Egyptians. Now God is saying that the time has come. Remember that the prophetic word that God released to Moses, when Moses said, "The Lord, our banner," hallelujah, "the Lord, our banner, arise." Hallelujah. He is our banner. He is great and mighty in battle. He's the one who fights our battles. Known and unknown. Visible and invisible. God is saying, the time has come. Saul was hiding. The Bible says that he was hiding amongst the luggage, the baggage, sorry. And he was hiding, behind some versions, they speak about the agricultural instruments. Amongst the woods, he was hiding. And Samuel had to go back to God and say, "Lord, where is the man you've marked?" And that was a sign, remember? I want to tell you, because that all things work all together for good. In case Israel, they think that Saul was the choice of the prophet. And the prophet in front of everyone, what he is doing now, he is looking up and speaking with God and saying, "Lord, where is the man you've called? Where is the man you've anointed? Where is the man you've chosen?" Because the man was waiting, was hiding, but the anointing was waiting. The man was suffering from low self-esteem while destiny awaited him. The Lord will locate you. Why? Because he has called you. The Bible declares men were sent to remove him. Hallelujah. I am here sent by God and to speak his word to remove you. Hallelujah. From that rejection, from hiding behind that rejection that you experienced growing up. I am here to remove you from the hate that you had to endure, from unprovoked people that you did absolutely nothing wrong, but they hated you. But now you understand we don't fight against flesh and blood, but against principalities and rulers of darkness. Now we know that God forgive us our sins as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lord, remove me from unforgiveness. Remove me from hiding behind bitterness. Remove me, oh God, from hiding behind fatherlessness. Remove me, oh God, from hiding behind this sexual or physical or emotional abuse that I endured and I took the posture of being a victim. Instead of embracing the mentality of a victim. Hallelujah. You know what Moses was doing here? You know what Moses is doing here? The story is narrated in Numbers chapter 13. A story is narrated in Deuteronomy chapter 1. Now Moses is saying, these ones, they refuse to enter. Remember, that's where we are. They refuse to enter the land. Now Moses is speaking to their generation He says to them, listen here, don't take the posture of a victim here. The victim mentality, it's not going to help you. Why it's not going to help you? It did not help them either. Altogether. It did not help them either. It's time now to rise up. That's what Moses is saying. It's time now to rise up and not sin as your forefathers sin. In other words, they sabotaged their own breakthrough. They aborted their own breakthrough. They frustrated their own destiny. They penned through the power of their tongue, their fate, their destiny. All together here, because the author in the book of Hebrews is telling us that generation, they died because they never mixed the message with faith. Are we together? They never took God and His word, because faith, it is to take God and His word. Faith, it is to act on what God said. Hallelujah. Faith, it is an act of obedience to what God said. For we don't walk by sight, we walk by faith. Hallelujah. The Red Sea can stand before us, but by faith we see our God who dried up the Red Sea, and the children of Israel cross over to pursue their destiny, replicating His mighty exploits and wonders in our generation. In our generation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There is something that is important. Then I give you some few points. Then I close. There is something that is important that Moses is saying to them. I want you to mark this. What Moses is saying to them. Because how do you deal with discouragement? Because now remember, trauma is encoded and is transferred. They find themselves in front of Canaan and with the river Jordan in front of them and the giants, all right? And the forefathers, they were afraid, intimidated by these giants to a point where their faith was disarmed, their courage was contaminated by the negative report. Now Moses is saying to them, don't replicate their failure. You see, brother, in these two narratives, what we learn here, we cannot ignore the shortcomings and the failures of the past. Why are you saying that, Pastor? The Bible, because everything that is written in the Bible, it was written for our word, admonishing, for us to learn from their pitfalls, for us to learn from their mountaintop lives, they are victorious and lives and their victories, but we also learn their lowest moments. We learn from their lowest moments. For instance, if you say that God forgave David for committing adultery, but now I hear you, have mercy on him, God, according to your loving kindness, according to your tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Oh Lord, my sin is forever before you. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Restore a steadfast realm of the joy of your salvation. And let me teach transgressors no more.
Good. That's the repentance of David,
and God forgave him. Oh wow. And therefore, let me go to fornication. Let me go to adultery. Let me go to perversion, to homosexuality. Let me go to pervert and live in whatever way I want to live. Because God is a forgiving Father, He's a gracious Father. No, God is loving. God is gracious. God is loving, God is gracious. And God loves all of us. The sun lights up upon the righteous and the unrighteous. Rain comes upon the righteous farmer and the unrighteous farmer. It is like God said, I love a sinner, but a sinner through my love that I have shown to the sinner, then that sinner must see my goodness in that love, so that my goodness can bring the sinner to his knees into repentance, because it is the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. Hallelujah. In another other words, God's love is pure. God's love is righteous. Now, when you talk about love, you are talking about a person here. You are talking about God himself. Because God is love. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So if God then is love, then you begin to say, no, let me go and do it. Let me tell you something. When you say, let me go and do what David did, you may not come back.
As he came back, as he did.
You may not come back. You may not come back. And again, when you do your forensic about the life of David, you must also understand that, are you prepared to endure the consequences of his fornication and adultery? Because the baby died. Amnon raped his own sister. There's nothing here called half-sister here. There's no half-sister here. Whether your mothers are not the same, when your father you have the same father, that is your sister. There's nothing called half-sister here. Half-sister is if, when it's half, then there's another half has a room that you can last. That's your sister. That is called incest. Happening in the house of David. Absalom overthrew his father from the throne. He wanted to kill his own dad. I don't know how to. And had sexual relations with the concubine of his dad in daylight. Now, do you want to endure such immorality and wickedness happening in your house as a result of a door you have opened? You get what I'm trying to say? You get it? So it means the life of David, it mirrors our lives. That one, I must not replicate. That I must never, I must not repeat. I must not copy. I must not imitate. Read 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. John the Apostle will always tell you, my children, don't imitate what is evil. Hallelujah. Instead, what I'm trying to come to here is that even when it's a failure, read the Bible. Even when it speaks about the life of Samson, at that moment, read the Bible. Even it speaks about David, at that moment, read the Bible. Because we are going to extract pearls that will make you wiser and stronger and better. That is now you are learning through God's wisdom. Because worldly wisdom will tell you, experience it. Go through it. Suffer. Repeat the same thing, and it's going to burn your vision. It's going to burn your calling. It's going to burn your faith. Hallelujah. And Moses is standing there, and he says to them, let's look back 40 years ago. What happened 40 years ago? What happened 40 years ago? So that we don't repeat it now. Because now you are at the brink of possessing your what? Your land. Hallelujah. Don't be like the Ephraimites who were armed for the day of the battle, but they turned, hallelujah, from the battle. In other words, they had the resources to prevail. They had the ability to take over and to conquer. But on the day of the battle, they were discouraged and they turned from the battle. Hallelujah. I rebuke that spirit of discouragement in your life in the name of Jesus Christ. It's not going to be your portion. Courage is going to be your portion. Boldness is going to be your portion. Persistence is your portion. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now the Bible says here, and the Lord your God who goes before you, he will fight for you according to all he did for you in Egypt before your eyes. Now listen. Now what Moses is simply doing here, it is that.
You have never heard about chemo.
Or rather, let me chemotherapy. So chemo, what they are simply doing through chemo, it's to make sure that which is killing you, that they also, it also becomes a what? An antidote to your health.
Okay, let me leave that one. Let me go to this one. Immunization. When you are hypnotized
for body, they put you body.
The vaccine. Hello? Hello? Hello?
So that by the time it wants to invade your system, it can't.
Okay, man, yeah, yeah.
Let's talk about flu vaccines. Why do they say before we give you the flu vaccine, you must ensure that you don't have the what? Because what we will be giving you will be giving you what?
Let us not
try to overcall it. I'm not a doctor, but what we are giving you, it's going to fight the flu that is going to come to you. So we are giving you the flu, and this one is not going to kill you. It is an antidote to the flu that will simply invade your system.
Is this difficult?
No. Some people say we can. It's a desktop research.
If we can check it. Alright?
So the one we give you as a doctor, it's not going to kill you, but it is going to strengthen up your immune system so that when the real killer comes, that it is able to identify it before it comes at you and deal with it to get it. So I am for immunization. I was immunized, my children are immunized. Alright? So now, why am I sharing that? It's because
years ago, they were told about the giants without having a profile of the giants,
by just looking
on the surface that they are gigantic,
and they were afraid. Moses, 40 years later, he, instead now of speaking about the giants, he's changing, he's giving them another lens
of seeing the giants. Alright? And then what he does,
he says to them, your God delivered you from Egypt. That's a point of departure.
Now, what did he do? The Lord your God who goes before you, he will fight for you according to all he did for you in Egypt.
And I don't need to mention it one by one. You know how he turned the Nile River into blood. You know how he caused the land of the Egyptians, even in their bathrooms, even in their living room, wherever they were, there were frogs. You know the locusts that came and devoured their harvest, but your harvest, caution, it was untouched.
You know
how that I killed the firstborn. They know, but Moses said before, now we deal with how you view the giants. Your outlook needs to change. Your world view needs to change. Because now how you view the giants, it must not be based on what you are capable of doing. It must be based on what your God is capable of doing. Now, when you look at your problem like that, then there is no room for despondency. There is no room for fear. There is no room for discouragement. Because now, when your first response is not based on what can I do, what do I have, but your first response is based on what your God can do.
To get it?
In other words, he says, feed now in his goodness.
What did he do for you?
How did he snatch you out of that accident? How did he deliver you from the hand of the Egyptians?
Feed on that. He's giving them. He's vaccinating them. So that they don't give Joshua a problem. When they enter the land,
they repeat what happened 40 years ago. Feed on his goodness. Alright? And then he says, and in the wilderness, where you saw how the Lord your God carried you as a man carries his son. Now, that speaks about God's provision. a son, a man carrying a wife, a son. Why a man carrying a son? It means you were vulnerable, you were like a baby in the wilderness. But the wilderness was so harsh, the wilderness was so dry and barren, the wilderness was dangerous. According to the book of Deuteronomy, it says, through all that great and terrible wilderness which you saw on the way to the mountains of Amorites, the wilderness was terrible, the wilderness was great, the storm was great, but your Lord, your God, carried you like a man that carries his own son. Even at the point of your vulnerability and your weakness, you were carried. I don't believe that he brought me this far, but he carried me. He carried me. It was not my wisdom that carried me. It was not my education that carried me. It was not my money that carried me. But it was the Lord that carried me. He carried me. He carried me. Now he says, yet for all that you did not believe the Lord your God. We will continue this message. Yet in all that you did not believe in your Lord your God. Now you must contextualize it. That in other words, Moses, he is speaking here with the generation, hallelujah, that is about to cross over. Hallelujah. Yet, even though he delivered them, he bore them out of Egypt like the mother eagle who bears her eaglets on her wings. That's how the Lord delivered you. Even though he dried up the Red Sea and you cross over to pursue your death, even your destinies, even though you even sang a song that he's a man of war, he had drowned the soldiers of Egypt with their armory, hallelujah, where in the Red Sea you sang a song of deliverance, singing the beauty, the greatness of your God. But when you were faced with the opposition, when you were faced with a resistance, when you were faced with an obstacle, you did not believe that the same God who did that yesterday, he can do it today. Hallelujah. And they ended up wandering in the wilderness. Hallelujah. The dead spies said, no, we are unable to take the land of Egypt. It is a land that devours its own people. Yeah, we are a grasshoppers in our own eyes. So we were in their sight. But I am here to tell you, child of the living God, when God says possess it, possess it. When God says take it, take over, take it over. Why? Because you are able, you can. Able means prevail, able means capacitated, able means divine resources. In other words, you have the divine resources, hallelujah, to do it. The giants, they erased the way of destiny in their lives. What God said to them, it was erased. And how many a times when we go through storms, when we go through our own giants and Goliath, we forget about what God said. We forget about what the word of God says, which is the word that must give us the lens through which we must view the enemy. See the enemy the way God sees the enemy. Hallelujah. In other words, it might be a challenge. It might be a storm. It might be lack. It might be unemployment. Whatever that you are going through, that is a giant. That is a storm that you feel like, no, this is insurmountable. No, this is impossible. I cannot do this. But now, don't allow, hallelujah, your challenge to erase the word of destiny in your life. That will be our point of departure when we leave that step.
When we meet again,
we are going to continue from this point,
because discouragement is a spirit that
the late Billy Graham,
he said,
God
Can man use a discouraged servant? And that is exactly will be our point of departure when we continue with this message. What made them to sit down for 16 to 15 years, not rebuilding the temple? It was because of discouragement. The enemy is excited when you pursue holiness, but with a discouraged spirit. He's excited when you go to church, you read the Bible, you praise, worship, you do everything. As long as you are discouraged, he knows that you are going to be a believer that is waiting to go to heaven. But on earth, you are not going to be effective and efficient. It takes courage. Courage it is to rise in the face of danger. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is to rise in the face of danger. I am afraid, but I'm moving forward. I'm afraid, but I'm soldiering on. I'm afraid, I am determined and tenacious. I'm afraid, I am not giving in, I am not giving up. I am afraid, hallelujah, but I believe. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, we bless you, we honor you, we give you the glory, we give you the praise. Let your word nourish, let your word empower, let your word strengthen us, in Jesus' mighty name. We thank you, Father, that Lord, as there are voices, our inner voice, the voice of the world, the voice of that disappointment, the voice of that rejection. Yes, the voice of that self-induced problem and failure. I pray, Father, that it will not be louder than the voice of destiny. The voice of courage and faith. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen and amen. May the Lord richly bless you. Thank you so much for joining us. God bless you.